Well-known author, investment banker, consumer advocate, analyst, trader, Chris Markowski is the watchdog on Wall Street.
You want answers?
Exposing the lies and myths that the big brokerage firms, the mainstream press, and the government are pushing to keep Americans away from financial freedom.
You can't handle the truth.
Bringing America the truth about what really happens in the financial world.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're not here to indulge in fantasy, but in political and economic reality.
This is the Watchdog on Wall Street.
Welcome, everybody. All right, we're going to delve right into it. A great, great interview this past week with Berkshire Hathaway's Charlie Munger talking about the current climate. Again, as many of my long-term listeners know, we, I think, in a similar fashion, the guys over at Berkshire. Now, Berkshire is a completely different model than what we do over at Markowski Investments. Berkshire invests a lot of private companies, obviously can build massive positions in certain stocks, which in some cases makes it a little less nimble than what, well, a lot less nimble than what we can do at Markowski Investments. But the philosophy is the same when it comes to looking for value, when it comes to understanding that companies have an intrinsic value to them. You better find out what it is, and you want to buy below that intrinsic value. Well, Charlie Munger, I don't know. Well, he's got to be almost 98 years old. Got to be around there if I'm thinking right. He was talking about the valuations that we're seeing today and how expensive things have gotten when it comes to the markets, and in many cases, certain areas of the market a lot crazier than it was during the 1990s dot-com run-up. And I agree. We've been talking about that for a long time. And I know many people out there they're hurting right now. There's a lot, especially a lot of new investors out there that made the mistake of defying, it's not even an investment rule, it is a life rule. Okay, a life rule here at Markowski Investments and the Watchdog on Wall Street radio show. Everything in life that has meaning, value, and worth involves work, time, and effort. And it's even funny. You go back to the movie Wall Street with Lou Mannheim. Lou Mannheim telling Bud Fox and his buddies, young stockbrokers, schlock brokers, about some good companies. And, oh, no, it's going to take too long for that company. It's going to take too long for that. He's like, sometimes good things take time. And that most certainly is the case. And a lot of, and I see this, I've been doing this long enough now, where it's multi-generational as far as people making mistakes. And listen, it's not just new investors, it's old investors too. A get-rich-quick con artist, what do they sell? What they sell. They sell greed or they sell fear. That's how they sell their stuff. And when I'm going to be honest with you. When I first entered the business, that's what they were telling the young schlock brokers. Paint a picture, champagne wishes and caviar dreams. Yeah. In order to sell what they wanted us to sell. Fundamentals matter. Valuations matter. What we're looking at right now, though, and Munger points this out also, is just a lot of good companies are also trading at much higher multiples. And what that means is it's going to be a little bit more difficult. A little bit more difficult to see some of these outsized returns moving forward. And again, this is where we circle back to what we discuss here on the program of going out and trying to find the best safe yields you can find and compounding those yields over time. I remember stirring the whole, it was a mess, you know, the whole financial crisis. Everybody is freaking out all over the place. We're trying to calm everybody the hell down on television, on radio, this program. It's not the end of the world. It's going to only happen one time. And there, Warren Buffett came out and he stated, he said, if a stock I own goes down 50%, I'd look forward to it. In fact, I would offer you a significant sum of money if you could give me the opportunity for all of my stocks, the things that I believe in, the good companies that I own, to go down 50% over the next month. Again, Buffett, Munger, guys like myself, ourselves at Markowski Investments, we can keep our cool. The madness of crowds, not so much. Not so much. But again, I know, again, you're watching the screen and, oh my God, all the pundits on TV are freaking out and they're printing pictures. They're printing pictures in the papers, the traders holding their heads, the stock photography's coming out, collective freak out. But if you own quality, you know it's going to come back at some point in time and you can buy it at a discount. And again, it's fascinating if you actually think about it. Think about how people will look for sales, deals, whatever it may be. I have an example. I was out with my wife. It was about a week or so ago, and I guess I got some friends and family thing that my wife knows about, I don't know about, at Bloomingdale's, and there was a blazer there, and I tried it on, and it fit perfect, except I got to get the sleeves fixed. Friends and family deal. And you're going to get this deal. And it's going to be 50% off. Well, and I see it's a high quality. Well, you know what? I'll get it. I'll buy it. I got a high quality item on sale. How many people do this? Oh, no, we're going to wait. We got a sale coming out. You got to buy a lawnmower. Lawnmower is going to cost you $400. But you know what's going on sale next week for $250. What are you going to do? Same lawnmower. Is it any less of a lawnmower at $250? No, it's value. You see what Munger understands, what Buffett understands, what we understand is that we own fantastic businesses. We own fantastic businesses. And when you have that knowledge, why wouldn't you want to purchase shares on the cheap? Why wouldn't you want to get involved when things dip? Huh? What wouldn't that make sense? Again, I talk about intrinsic value. Buffett and Munger talk about intrinsic value. It's not theirs. It's Benjamin Graham's, who wrote The Intelligent Investor, I don't know, in the 1940s. I can't even tell you. I don't even know. But read it a long, long time ago. Listen, I've been beating this drum a lot here on the program, and not just the past several weeks. I've been doing it not years, but decades. More money is lost. I can't tell you. The story after story, they pop into my head. I'm talking about people that contact. I sold my entire portfolio in a financial crisis, and I bought gold and silver coins. You did what? Can't come back from that because you've just lost a ton of money on your stupid coins that are collecting dust. I know the guy on television likes to fondle them. Think about this for a second. More money is lost due to irrational behavior rather than asset allocation and even stock selection. And listen, I get it. Okay? And we've talked about it here in the program. Everybody's situation is unique and different. Everybody's situation is unique and different. You know, I'll give you an example here. I've got three kids. Put money aside for them in college. I've got one son who's in college right now. The money that I put aside to pay for his tuition, let me tell you where it's not. It's not in the market. It's not in the market because I need cash. And what if happens if the market does correct for a period of time? Which can happen. Capital money that you need to have access to. Yeah, you got to have certain parts of your portfolio if you need that money in cash and cash equivalents. I can smell, I can cite irrational investor behavior from far, far away. What we've seen as of late, and I've actually been talking a little bit about this when it comes to the markets that bounce back from the Omicron panic porn sell-off that I do think was a big rope-a-dope. I know, be getting off the beaten track here a little bit. Somebody made a hell of a lot of money. Somebody knew before everyone else and was able to trade it. It just wasn't you and I, okay? Because I'm not a part of that big club. The old George Carlin big club that we're not in. I'm not a part of that club. I don't know anybody who's a part of that club, quite frankly, personally. Yeah, you can know them based upon the fact that they're in Washington. But anyway, somebody made a ton of money on that. After the Omicron fake out, you have to take a look at the overall market. Many overvalued companies have come down a significant amount of money. There's an actual index out there, Goldman Sachs index, that basically companies that are unprofitable, technology companies that are unprofitable, down big time. Big time. I think, what is it? It's almost every single IPO that came out this past year, I think except for one, is down from its listing price. Yeah, there's a myriad of reasons for that. Again, sometimes these market freakouts get rid of people buy stock on margin, borrow money, and then they get margin calls that they can't afford to pay, and then they have to sell off their position. But I think it's a little bit more than that. I also think eventually, you know, the old saying, cream rises to the top. Valuations matter. And this is why we pay closest attention to fundamentals, valuation. Oh, I know the technical stuff is cute. But what difference does it make what the market does if you have a long-term philosophy, time frame? What difference does it make what the market does over the short term? Anyway, we're going to take a quick break right here. Let's delve a little bit further into this. Got a lot we got to go over on the program today. I'm actually going to do a book with you later. Unbelievable book. I couldn't put the bloody thing down, for crying out loud. A lot of great stuff. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com is our site. Take advantage of all the great stuff we have. In particular, our personal CFO program. This is obviously the number one thing on our site, without a doubt. People taking advantage, utilizing us, utilizing our attorneys, our accountants. Basically, it's a family office for you. And guess what? You don't need to have a $10 million account to work with us. We help everyone. Take advantage. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com or give us a call, 800-471-5984. We'll be back.
The only man who is taking on the Wall Street establishment. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street with Chris Markowski.
Welcome back, everybody. It is the Watchdog on Wall Street show. Always honored to have you tuned in to the program. Everybody kind of understand, okay? Go back to what we were talking about prior to the break. Your concern... You're concerned when things start going a little haywire. And this is something you should ask yourself in regards to what you have in your portfolio. Don't concern yourself with what's working right now, but rather what will work over time. Just that simple. And the answer, what's going to work over time, it's value, fundamentals, dividends. No matter what the markets are doing. Okay, we talk about faith and patience and discipline. Okay, don't deviate from that. Or you're going to pay a heavy, heavy price. Now, again, what we're going to start seeing now, we're starting to see it already. Oh my God, today on the business program, we're going to have some of the hottest fund managers out there. They're so hot. Yeah, you did well for a year. You did well for a quarter. Again, you need to understand, they need to create these stars. They need to create these stars, these super duper fund managers, because they need stuff to talk about. Ad nauseum again and again and again. What are the hot funds? What were the hot funds for 2021? What are going to be the hot funds for 2022? Right. Sure. It's a sales pitch. It really is. There's no such a reliable list of hot funds. Come on, man. Let me tell you a quick story. I think I mentioned this before on the program. This is, wow, it's going back, it's got to 15, 20 years at least. My brothers and I, we were meeting with an office in, it was in Venice, Florida. In Venice, Florida, this guy wanted to sell his business. Didn't want to work in the industry anymore and wanted to sell us his business and wanted us to take it over. So we went, we met with this guy. And again, I it doesn't take me long. It really doesn't. But I can't be rude. I just can't walk out on stuff. I knew it wasn't going to be a fit. And this guy was incredibly annoying. He was actually bragging to us about the time that, you know, he was written up and pictures of the newspapers, top fund manager going. This guy was a star. How did they know? And he was basically touting the fact that his portfolio was in cash, entirely in cash, nothing else. In October of 1987. Now, what happened? October 1987. Okay. Big crash, right? It's not like he went from selling all his stocks and bonds and knew that the crash was going to happen and went to cash. He couldn't buy anything. He didn't have his authorization yet. He told us that. It was a brand new fund. And his entire portfolio was in cash during the crash. And the media said, wow, this guy's a star. He's so smart. Yeah, that's like me claiming that I am, you know, brilliant and smart because I can go to a roulette table and pick a number. No. No. Again, don't buy into this stuff. I want to talk a little bit about compounding, because I mention it often here on the program. It's been a major part of our portfolios. It is of incredible importance simply because, again, you take a look at the overall markets as a whole. Jeremy Siegel's done this, Wharton professor, University of Pennsylvania, tracking all asset classes going back hundreds of years. Stocks outperform everything, and a lot of that has to do with compounding dividends. Albert Einstein. What did he say? Compounding interest, the greatest invention of mankind, since it allows for the reliable, systematic accumulation of wealth. Ben Franklin called compounding the eighth wonder of the world. Franklin put $4,500 of his money to be loaned out at interest for 200 years. $4,500. It was $5 million, and then it was distributed to the city of Boston in 1993. Always take advantage of the best safe yields you can find and stick with them over time. It works. It works, and that's what's key. You know the greatest performance year? I mentioned Berkshire Hathaway. You know what the best year they've ever had? It's 24%. That's a great year. We've had some great years. And again, this is one portfolio each. We don't have a fund. Everybody's account, everybody's situation is unique and different. It's not what we do. But think about that. Not doubles and triples. I mean, it's a phenomenal performance. 24%, phenomenal. One of the things we discussed, and I talked about it last week on the program, about, you know, not speculating on nonsense with the bulk of your portfolio. Get it. You get to a certain point of time and you want to take a tiny portion of your portfolio and take a flyer on some idea or something. Fine. Knowing, like a gambler, knowing that you could lose it all, that's fine. But you cannot do that with your entire portfolio. Remember the movie Wall Street? Gordon Gekko telling Bud Fox, "I don't like losses, sport. Nothing ruins my day more than losses." I know I sound like Master the Obvious right now, but I'll get further into it. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Don't go anywhere. Back.
Chris Markowski is the Watchdog on Wall Street. You should believe in math, not magic. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street with Chris Markowski.
We're back, everybody. It is The Watchdog on Wall Street show. Yeah, losses. Nothing ruins my day more than losses, right? Well, you're going to see a lot of losses. You're going to see a ton of losses if you treat your portfolio like a casino. Eventually, you will lose your money. Eventually. It's not a matter of if, it's just a matter of when. If you compound, you want to create wealth. You want to really create wealth. You compound small gains over long periods of time. When you take big losses, it can set you back years. Again, this is simple math. And when I throw it out to people, they get thrown off. You have $100,000 invested. I'll just use that number. You lose 50%. You're down to $50,000. You lost 50%. What do you got to make back? What percentage you got to make back to get back to where you were? People are like, 50%. No! You're down 50%. You got to see 100% to get back to where you were. I wrote this down years ago. I had to put it in a column or two. Mark Twain. Mark Twain in 1873. October. This is one of the purely dangerous months to speculate in stocks. The others are July, January, September, April, November, May, March, June, December, August, and February. He went on next year to write The Gilded Age, which went after investment crooks and politicians and media liars. Again, the more things change, the more they stay the same. Again, the world's second oldest profession, get-rich-quick con artists. Sir Isaac Newton lost a fortune when the South Sea investment bubble burst in 1720. He stated, I can calculate the motions of the heavenly bodies, but not the madness of people. It's a cliche that most people ignore. Buy low, sell high. Whether it's a South Sea investment company, railroad stocks in the 1800s, dot-coms, Southwest Florida condos, it's unfortunate. Investors cannot avoid it. It's like a black hole. It's a tractor beam. Okay, that people get involved. Asset prices move in long patterns, up and down. Don't rush. Don't rush. And again, FOMO. FOMO. That should be the index. That's what Goldman Sachs should call their unprofitable technology index. They should call it the FOMO index, the fear of missing out index. I said this before here on the program, and I've been asked countless times, hey, what are some of the best investments you've ever made? I'd say the best investments we've ever made are the investments we didn't make, the things that we chose to stay away from. And yeah, do we miss the bottom? Yeah, sure. Of course we do. And you know, an example I like to use is Amazon. When Amazon came out, Amazon sold books online. Sold books online. There were other companies at the same time that were selling stuff online. Pets.com. Remember the sock puppet commercials that they used to have? CD Now. There's lots of companies selling stuff online. If Amazon just stuck with books, probably wouldn't be here today. They were able to change their business. Amazon was too speculative for us when it first came out. Down the road, oh, geez, it's doing this, that, and the next thing. Well, you know what? I feel safer with this. There's nothing wrong with that. You got to take that whole FOMO thing, and you're going to have to get rid of it. Listen, people, okay? I know. I've been doing this here a long time. If I came on the program today, and I started saying, oh, my God, we have put together a list of the hottest stocks for 2022. We've been speaking to this. You know, my email, server would probably break down because people would be like, I got to get it. I got to get in right now. Oh, my God. Murkowski's got something. Notice we've never done that. Well, again, I haven't had an ethical bypass at birth, but it's not real. It's not real. In the immortal words of Donnie Brasco, that's a fugazi. We're not fugazis. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. Again, become a part of the Watchdog on Wall Street family. Sign up for our personal CFO program. What else we got? Our podcast, account repair kits, all sorts of great stuff there at the site. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com or give us a call, 800-471-5984.
Bringing America financial freedom one listener at a time. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street with Chris Markowski.
All righty, changing directions here. Oh, my God. We got breaking news. Guess what? There's a new symptom. Geez, just when you thought, oh, my God, this is COVID. They've discovered another symptom that goes along with COVID. This is from the Biden administration. The Biden administration says that you get COVID, I guess you're more apt to do smashing grabs, commit a crime. That's right. They came out. The root cause of crime in America right now, the culprit for America's crime wave is COVID. Who knew? You get COVID, you might start, doing a smash and grab for crying out loud. Yeah. I mentioned this earlier on in the program. I've been able to put the book down. I'm about, I guess, about 85, 90% through it at this point in time. Is Dr. Scott Atlas's book, A Plague Upon Our House. This is not an opinion book. He breaks down everything that happened behind the scenes, what we didn't say, what we didn't see happening at all these meetings with Dr. Birx and Fauci and Rentenfield from the CDC. And I explained on the podcast this past week. It's one of those books where you're saying things, you're like, wow, yeah, I knew that. Yeah, that didn't make any sense. But you don't know whether to laugh or cry. And what I mean by that is that we have these people that are, for all intents and purposes, completely incompetent. And you're going to read it, you're going to see how bad it is. Completely incompetent. And you're going to also see how spineless people are. And this is dealing with public health. And I'm thinking to myself, I was in my car and I was thinking about it. I was, it's a wonder that we have lasted so long as a nation. And we've lasted so long as a nation because of our private sector. The fact that we have a private sector and people out there that make the country work. These people in Washington, they make everything worse. Everything worse. Ignoring ignoring everything that we know to be true. I remember talking about this here on the show, on the podcast. I'm like, wait a second. I remember this from college biology. I remember this stuff, that they're not being truthful. This doesn't make any sense. And I was right. But guess what? You'll probably see the same faces. I don't know. Dr. Birx, she disappeared. Oh, man. I kid you not. You have no idea how vapid that lady is. You have to read the book. But you watch this stuff and you kind of get a grasp on what I've been trying to get across here, just how we need less government, less regulations. We don't want to have public-private partnerships. We don't want any of that. Look at what they did. You had a Biden Surgeon General this past week, youth facing pandemic mental health issues. No kidding. What did you think was going to happen with all your godforsaken lockdowns and shutdowns and closing schools? Then you get everybody freaking out about Omicron. I'm like, what? Have we lost our minds? But that's okay. Never fear. In the city of New York, Bill de Blasio, you can shoot up drugs in the street, smoke pot wherever you want. But unless you're vaccinated, you can't work. That's his latest mandate there. Couldn't make the stuff up if I wanted to. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back.
You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street. Taking Wall Street's liars, crooks, and cheats out behind the woodshed. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street.
Couple more COVID thing before we get into some of these ripoffs and scams I want to get to. Trevor Noah, who is the host of The Daily Show, he's a far left wing host. And quite frankly, I don't think he's, and I ain't even close to as good as Jon Stewart. I really don't. It's almost like they should have renamed the program. It's kind of unfair to him. But again, I'm not a huge fan, but he's a bright guy. I don't agree with his politics at all, but I actually saw eye to eye with him. He did a segment where he said, wait a second. Whoa. Basically, I'm paraphrasing. He said, nobody has been really sick from this Omicron thing. Nobody. Yet we've got the CEO of Moderna coming out saying that everybody's going to have to be vaccinated for it. And they're going to have to line up and get another vaccine. And he pointed out, he said, wait a second. This company's going to make hundreds of millions of dollars on this. Yet nobody has gotten seriously sick. Why are we doing this? It's basically, I'm paraphrasing, his point. And I agree. But you had the left wingers came out. You sound like those anti-vax people. I mean, people, you're going to line up for a shot weekly now? For every, what's next on the alphabet? Pi, the Greek alphabet? They're going to line up for another shot then too? Really? Actually, it's gotten so bad, the state of Oregon is thinking about making their mask mandate permanent. That's right. Well, we'll just make it permanent and, maybe we'll get rid of it later on down the road. And I'm going to mention this. Rand Paul said it as well. The reason why people are hesitant to get vaccinated is that you people in Washington, D.C. can't get your story straight. You can't get your story straight. You keep changing the tune all the time. You keep moving the goalposts all the time. You lie to us about the efficacy of these vaccines. Great. I mean, it's fantastic. Should have told us in the beginning, you know what? It might help you from getting COVID, but it's certainly your outcome is going to be better. Don't lie. Just be honest, for crying out loud. Anyway, I gotta get into this next story. I'm tying two things together here. Did you see this? This mega church. Joel Osteen, Joel Osteen, yes, the preacher with the yachts and the private jets and the mega churches. I don't get it. Did you see that a plumber happened to find $600,000 in a wall behind a toilet? Now, I guess the church was robbed back in 2014 or 15, something like that. I guess what went missing? $600,000. And again, insurance gave them the money back. Insurance, that was insured. They got their money from that. How and why would it get in the wall? And why is that? You don't see a single media outlet asking that question? How in the world did the money get behind the wall unless somebody put it there? Yeah, something's rotten. But anyway, I got to talk about this as well because, and I know I've talked about this a lot lately, but it continues to happen. Continues to happen, and I'm being honest. It happens at many of these mega churches. That's right. Many of these mega churches. What does Osteen preach? Some sort of philosophy in regards to prosperity or something like that? Did you know that you get the schlock brokers and the bad financial advisors, they go to these things to just fish for clients? Yeah. Fish for clients. There was a Merrill Lynch rep that just got nailed. Actually, they're going to actually send this guy to jail for a period of time, swindling millions upon millions upon millions of dollars from people. How did he get them? Oh, in church. That's where he's cruising for clients. I mean, I it's not something. I'm not a schmoozer, in case you hadn't realized that yet. You get a lot of these guys that, here, especially where I live in the North Shore of Long Island, they'll sign themselves up for every golf club, every yacht club out there. And, they must be able to drink a bottle of scotch a weekend for crying out loud, trying to schmooze people and get clients. I don't do that. No, I don't even golf. No, not my bag. Haven't, got kids, young kids, haven't learned how to play the game yet. I'm sure I'll play someday, but it's not my bag. You mean to tell me you go to a church? You use the church, you use God to sell your business? Did you ask him? Yeah, it's okay. I don't understand this, people, and I can't tell you. I don't know if it's becoming more prevalent or the news is getting out. It's always been bad. But not a week goes by where I'm not getting another story from some con artist that took people at a prayer group, a church, whatever it may be. A ton of this stuff happening in Texas at this point in time. I as a rule, okay, anybody tries to use their faith to sell me something, I'm going to run. I don't trust them immediately. Your bull excrement meter should be going off. You know, you're going to be able to judge people based upon their actions, their competence. The old, preach the gospel, sometimes use words. I find it offensive. Listen, okay, it never happened to me at my church. Someone actually solicit? What, in coffee hour after Mass? Who does that? Honestly. And again, why don't you rethink who you're doing business with? People, countless stacks. People. Millions of dollars gone. He was such a wonderful young fella. He could cite the Gospels with the best of them. Come on, people. Wake up. Wake up. Be smart. Be smart. Don't do dumb stuff. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. We'll be back.
Chris Markowski is the Watchdog on Wall Street. Well-known author, investment banker, consumer advocate, analyst, trader, Chris Markowski is the Watchdog on Wall Street.
You want answers?
Exposing the lies and myths that the big brokerage firms, the mainstream press, and the government are pushing to keep Americans away from financial freedom.
You can't handle the truth.
Bringing America the truth about what really happens in the financial world.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're not here to indulge in fantasy, but in political and economic reality.
This is the Watchdog on Wall Street.
Okay, welcome everybody. It is the Watchdog on Wall Street show. Always honored to have you tuned into the big program here. We're going to get into some societal stuff, and it's important. Again, if you came to the Watchdog on Wall Street show to think that I'm going to start doing buy, sell, and hold, you've come to the wrong place. You want to go get bad advice? Okay, go listen to another local yokel schlock broker with their weekly program that'll be on the air for a couple months until they run out of money, and then they'll move on to the next one. It's not what we do. And that's why we're the longest running financial program in the country. We talk about things that are important and understanding trends here in this country, because it helps. It helps when it comes to positioning money over the long term, long trends. Not next week, not next month, not next year. Over a lengthy period of time. I've talked for a long time here on the program, the direction. It's been a constant direction. A little bit, somewhat of a blowback to some degree under the Trump administration. I wish more was done. I really do. I understand what Donald Trump was fighting against, not only his own party, but the media as well. But even still, okay, sometimes he could be his own worst enemy. Again, we're equal opportunity bashers here on the program. I really loved the Republican Party platform back in 2016, and the things that they were trying to do was getting rid of breaking up the big banks and a change in foreign policy for the first time in a long time, and a myriad of different things, getting rid of regulations, lowering taxes, smaller government. But we just didn't do that. Couldn't even repeal and replace Obamacare. So what's my point? So, since the 1960s, it's been a pretty steady move to the left as far as this country is concerned. I'd have to say, and I'm being honest with you, the biggest pushback was the welfare reform that was done back in the 1990s when Newt Gingrich got Bill Clinton to go along, changed welfare. But now we're going back. And we're seeing the consequences of our poor choices. We're seeing the consequences of big government. I'm going to give you a headline here. It made me sad. It made me really sad. I haven't gone into the city. It was something we did every year. I haven't done it since pre-COVID. I'm most certainly not doing it now. It just makes me sad going into the city. We used to go in with the family, go to Rockefeller Center, take a family, quick family picture in front of the tree. Kids, kind of get bored, see some of the windows in front of Saks and the light show, go out, have a nice dinner, Bryant Park and a nice skating rink there, and like a little outdoor Christmas market. I'm not doing it now. I saw this story. It's terrible. Bank of America, who has a tower. I mentioned Bryant Park. Okay, Bryant Park is an area right behind the library museum. The library. Remember the library from Ghostbusters 1 where they're coming in and they go into the basement and you got the two lions out front? Well, Bryant Park is right behind that. And it was a major transformation with Bryant Park. And the Bank of America Tower is behind that. And it was just super safe area. You don't have to worry about a darn thing there. Now, you got the executives at Bank of America that are warning their junior staffers to dress down. That's right. You come to work, we want you to dress down. We want you to attract less attention because crime is that bad. They don't want their staffers. Make sure you're not wearing anything with a Bank of America logo. That's going to make you a target. What the hell happened, man? How did this happen? You talk about how fragile things are. New York was once the safest big city in the entire world. I watched the transformation. That's when I first moved to the city. Giuliani was coming in and what he did. One of my favorite authors, he's a professor. He's a professor at Stanford. He writes a lot of books on classical history, expert on ancient Greece and Rome. Victor Davis Hanson. I also see him on television from time to time. He's interviewed talking about the third worldizing of America and how we're becoming more and more and more like a third world country. I know this is, you know, I talked about this on the podcast, but I'd like everybody to just think for a second in your mind. I want you to think. When you think in your mind, kind of, you're not driving, close your eyes and try to imagine what a third world country is. Again, I've been to them. I've seen them. And you get a picture in your mind. I always kind of sub-reference to Romancing the Stone. You know, Joan Wilder, you know, coming out of this airport where it's just chaos everywhere, getting on a bus and there's chickens and pigs on the bus. Is this the bus to Cartagena? Okay. Anyway, let me tell you something about third world countries. Third world countries have a lot of really, really, really rich people. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. There's a lot of wealth. Lot of wealth in these countries, these third world countries. They control everything. They're the elites. They're the people on top. What third world countries do not have is they don't have a middle class. They don't have a middle class, and there's no upward mobility unless you go ahead and seize it by force. You're not moving up the ladder through traditional ways that we understand here in the United States, through hard work and hustle and busting your butt and doing all the right things. No. Anyway, you got to get upper mobility. It's just you got to have to take that by force. You know, I go on vacation with my family. We go to Greece in August, and you can see, you want to talk about yachts, mega yachts. Mega yachts. I mean, these yachts that you see there, and they're so massive, they have their own Wikipedia pages, for crying out loud. You can look them up and see what these boats have. One that I looked up a couple years ago, sonic cannons to keep away. I mean, the crap that they had. And if you take a look who owns, they actually say who owns these boats. They're always from some third world country. Yeah, they're always from some backwards third world country somewhere. Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Ukraine, Russia. I mean, a myriad of them. There's a lot of wealth there, but this is what we're doing. This is what we're doing to ourselves. And again, you got the people right now on the left pushing more and more handouts and giveaways. You know what that is? It's a drug. You're just placating people. That's all you're doing. That's all you're doing. We have to keep the peasants happy. Got to keep the peasants happy. So we, you know what? We can keep them away from us. We can keep them away. We got to keep the peasants happy. Keep them away from our houses. Again, that's not working right now in California. The elites are starting to freak out a little bit because people are following them home. Following them home and breaking into their holiday parties and just taking stuff. Well, we better hand out some more money to these people to keep them away. There was actually a, where was this? This is off CNBC. CNBC, again, this is, they might as well have made this column. They should have put a little tag underneath it. paid advertisement, because that's basically what it was. It was basically an advertisement for, you know, the wish list for the left. And here's the title of the article. Almost half of U.S. families with young children face high risk of poverty due to insecure employment. What? Oh, yes. Okay. Families are at risk. Risk. Young children at risk. Risk of falling into poverty. It's a major risk. Half the families have high risk of being in poverty the first 6 years of their child's lives. Insecure, precarious parental work. Again, these are the indicators they used to see whether or not the parents were in less than ideal employment situations. Work schedules, occupation, hourly wages, and weekly work hours. If those elements in parents' employment were unstable, their children more likely to experience poverty in their early years. Oh, stop it. Please stop it. Okay, for most people, and this is the way life is, you lose a job, it can be devastating to the family. This is why we have social safety nets. But the idea is to move on, pick yourself up. And let me, and again, I'm going to put this out there, and I've done it before. Again, I don't, no filter here, okay, outside of the words I'm not allowed to say on radio. If you can't afford to have kids, if you have a situation where, you know, gee whiz, my wife is unemployed. I'm unemployed. You know what? Let's have children. What are you, nuts? Are you kidding me? And basically this column was pushing for, yes, we need to do more to help families out and send them money. No. I know everybody, most people listening to this program, your grandparents get any money? From the government when they came here off a boat somewhere? Did they get any money from the government? Your parents get any money from them? Help them to pay for, I don't know, expenses? Pay for the trapper keeper back in the 1980s? No. And they push these ideas as, oh, it's so compassionate. It's the opposite. It's a prison. Is what it is. It's a drug. Let's just keep people in their own little spot here. Keep them happy. They won't bother us. That's not what we're about. It's not. We'll take a quick break here. We get back. I don't know if you saw this. The progressives in Congress are now backing a bill for a four-day work week. Could make this stuff up if I wanted to. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Again, I invite each and every one of you to become a part of the Watchdog on Wall Street family. Sign up for our personal CFO program. All sorts of great stuff at the site. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. We'll be back.
This is the Watchdog on Wall Street.
Yeah, here we go. You're talking about the reindeer and Santa Claus. Do you think Santa and his elves, they work 32-hour work weeks? I mean, it's a lot of work to get all these toys out and all this stuff out to all these kids. You think Santa works 32 hours a week? Does progressives in Congress, yep, they're lining up. They want a bill that would shrink the regular week of work from 40 hours to 32. Do you have any idea what that will do to businesses in this country? Again, the ideas that these lefties come up with, it's as if they're some utopian freshman college student sitting around a dorm with tapestries on the wall with the bong in the corner. There's no thought about the consequences. I'll give you an example. Let's say you are a restaurant. Say you're a restaurant, and you are a restaurant that opens up every day at 11 a.m. Open up at 11 a.m., and you close at 12 at night. All of a sudden, all of your employees that, you know, you pay certain people overtime to work in extra hours, but now you're going to have to pay that much more in overtime? Do you have any idea what that does to your business model? Because, again, you can't find workers, okay? You're going to have to cut people's hours. It's absolutely nuts. They want you to be peasants. This is the thing. They come out and they tell you, oh, gee, we're so compassionate. We're all in. No, they don't want you to do well. Let me ask you a question. Would you like your doctor to work 32-hour weeks? Again, it's not 32 hours. We got an hour lunch break, right? So we're down to 28. Yeah, do you think it's going to be easy to see a doctor if doctors can only work 28 hours a week? What about, hey, all my clients out there, would you like it if we at Markowski Investments were only working 32 hours a week? Huh? What about accountants? How do you think that's going to fly? What about farmers? Is it applicable to them? These people are out of their minds. For far too long, workers across this country have been forced to put in longer hours as their wages barely budge. Do me a favor, okay? Do me a favor, you fools. I had all of those minimum wage jobs. I did all that. And guess what? What I learned from those jobs, what I took from those jobs that has put me in the position that I'm at today. 32 hours a week. Yeah, because you know what's going to happen? Our big competitor in the world, China, I'm sure they're going to be doing the same thing, right? It's extraordinary. And people will just work more, and this will just be more of a divide. Somebody's going to have to pick up the slack. And we type A personalities that get up, do the old Ben Franklin, early to bed, early to rise, make a man wealthy, healthy, wealthy, and wise. We're just going to get wealthier as everybody else gets lazier. It is what it is. Anyway, I got to get into, you know, another inflation stories that this past week. I don't know if you saw this. I didn't believe it. I didn't think it was real. You know how many times a week I look at a story and I say, that can't be right. And I got to be like Santa Claus. Just checking it once, checking it twice, at least twice, 2 to 3 times. The Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee put out a tweet with a chart praising nobody messes with Joe Biden for lowering gas prices. Thanks at Joe Biden. A graph that had no start date showing gas prices going down by 2 cents from November 22nd to November 29th. The price of gas is well over a dollar more than it was a year ago. And they actually put this out? You know, the interesting thing is this. Again, this is the reality, okay? And I'm going to get into this a little bit later on. We've got some media stories I want to talk about. You see some of the dumb things that are put out, and it kind of insults you to some degree, just how stupid they are. It's not for your consumption. You understand? It's not. It's not for you, okay? Just as much as, you know, you get to a point in time where, guess what, you know, Sesame Street is not right here, Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. You grow out of certain things. This is for a much lower intelligence level. This is for people that are a part of the dumb donkey cult. These are for the true believers out there. It's not for your consumption. They'll put it out there. They'll eat it all up. They'll believe it. It's nonsensical. I know people. I know when you see this stuff, you get aggravated, you get angry. I do too. I'm trying to condition myself to some degree. This is not for me. This is not for me. They're just trying to keep people, you know, I say it all the time. The conspiracy to keep people poor and stupid. Conspiracy to keep people poor and stupid is alive and well. Anyway, yeah, we're getting into some of this inflation stuff when we get back. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com is our site. Again, become a part of what we do, our personal CFO program, our podcast, all sorts of great stuff. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. We'll be back.
While I tell of Yuletide treasure, fa la 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 la.
You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street. The only man who is taking on the Wall Street establishment. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street with Chris Markowski.
Welcome back, everybody. It is the Watchdog on Wall Street show. Inflation causing hardship for 45% of U.S. households. That's it? Just 45%? It's much worse than that. We talk a lot. We have talked a lot. It's been an ongoing discussion. Not just over the past year, 6 months, whatever it may be, where it's now become a little bit more prevalent, even though the powers that be, the smartest people out there, people in Washington, people at the Federal Reserve, oh, it's transitory. No, it never has been. Never has been. When it comes to inflation, we have been rock solid in our point that the things that matter most are the things that you need to survive on. The stuff that you utilize every day. The things you can live without your television set, right? You can't eat a TV. But you need to eat. And you need to heat your home. And you need to get back and forth to work and put fuel into your car. And you need to buy clothes. The things that you need to survive on have been going up for a very long time. So a story, global food prices, record high. Record high. But again, you get these Washington, D.C. types, these Elizabeth Warrens and many others of the world out there telling you about inflation. Telling you about inflation and, oh, no. No, it's not a monetary issue. No. No, couldn't be that. Oh, it's those terrible oil and gas companies. Oh, those oil and gas companies, they're colluding. They're working together. I keep going back to Godfather 1, where Michael Corleone is letting Carlo know that he knows that Carlo set up his brother. Ah, you set up Santino. And he tells him not to insult his intelligence. You see many of these people on TV and what they have to say, and that's what they continue to do. They continue again and again and again to insult our intelligence. You actually had some people from the energy industry come out and blast Elizabeth Warren. And it's not new. I mean, usually, I remember back in the day, remember Maxine Waters telling the oil companies in front of Congress that she wants to socialize them? And I'm basically just sitting there and taking it. Thank you, sir. May I have another? Again, I pointed this out. At some point in time, people, at some point in time, okay, you're going to have to start standing up for what's right. Okay? It was interesting. I mentioned Scott Atlas' book earlier on. And he talking about sitting in at these meetings and how everybody was afraid. And how he'd get calls from all of these doctors and epidemiologists, all these people, to tell him, you go, Scott. You keep saying what you're saying. But we're afraid to say anything. You're afraid. Yeah, people, you know, they don't want to be canceled. I don't want to be canceled. I don't want to rock the boat. I know something to be true, but instead I'm going to be a coward. Don't be that person. Please. Don't. Anyway, yeah, inflation. Inflation's transitory. Right, sure. Oh, quick on this, too. Yeah, it's another thing, a myth that they put out there. I know I talked about this on the podcast this past week. Inflation is a monetary issue, okay? The powers that be, the people in Washington, D.C., they love inflation. They need the Fed to print money. The Fed prints money for them so they can continue to spend. That's how it works. Not supply chain, not labor market. Now, oh, you get that one. The economy's overheating. Fred's got to keep the economy from overheating. Oh, that's a lie. When the economy picks up, guess what? It's actually deflationary. Yeah, companies can lower their prices. They invest in new technologies. They become more productive. Not less so, more productive. So guess what? That's when they lower prices. Take a look. I'll use this as an example. Take a look at competitive industries, shall you? All right. Look at competitive industries. Industries that have been high growth. Hey, take a look at technology, right? Price of computers, price of television, electronic items continue to drop. Continue to drop. Well, and that's high growth there. Take a look at industries that are stagnant. What happens to their price? They go up. Again, so that's a lie. It's a monetary issue. Anyway, she said this. And again, it hurts my head. I'm trying to stay cool, but again, insults our intelligence. You had the Treasury Secretary of the United States, that's right, claiming that Biden's $1.7 trillion spending plan, which is actually $5 trillion, will actually reduce annual deficits. That's right. Biden's going to spend all this money, throw around cash. We're giving away cash, child tax credit, giving away this. It's going to reduce deficits. You, the Treasury Secretary of the United States, actually say this. It's idiocracy is what it is. But anyway, got to take a break. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. Again, sign up for all the great stuff at our site. Take advantage. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. We'll be back. Jing-a-dee-jing. The Italian Christmas donkey.
Bringing America financial freedom one listener at a time. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street with Chris Markowski.
Yeah, we're in Christmas music mode here at The Watchdog on Wall Street show the next couple weeks here on the program. When we played on the way out of the last segment there, was it Dominic the Donkey, the Italian Christmas Donkey? I'm still, to this day, how much wine do you have to drink? Or was it you're drinking Campari or Strega? What were you drinking where you came up with that idea for a tune? Just out of curiosity. Anyway. All right. Guess what? More and more people coming out and saying that the Build Back Better Act will likely cost twice as much than the CBO projects. And I will, what was it? The Price is Right. You couldn't go over on the number then you would lose. I can't remember. The price is wrong. It's going to be much, much higher. Get your arms around people, how much we are spending, huh? At all. Yeah. That ridiculous, nonsensical, Was it 1.8, $1.7 trillion COVID bill that Biden shoved down our throats when he first came into office? And we got the infrastructure bill again. Republicans, like usual, cave and let Biden pass that, knowing that we got another $2 trillion, actually $5 trillion, actually much more bill coming down the pike. People, I try to explain it to you this way when it comes to all of this money printing, okay? There's not enough taxes to pay for any of this stuff. It's ridiculous, okay? The numbers, again, if you try to get your arms around them, you can't. You can't. You go and you buy stuff. You go and you buy stuff, you go to the store, and you get your receipt, and you're looking at it, and you're saying, this is what I paid for in stuff. And then you get your sales tax, right? Where I live, it's over 8% sales tax. But there's something there that you don't see. okay? Unless you can see it, unless you're aware of the matrix, the crap that they're pushing on you all the time. Inflation is a tax. The value of your dollar continues to drop because they have to continue to print money to pay for all of their stuff. Yeah, my concern is this. It's getting late in the game this year. And what these people in Washington like to do is they like to pass stuff when nobody's paying attention. Oh, America's paying attention. They're watching It's a Wonderful Life tonight. We'll pass some huge spending bill at 11 o'clock at night on December 24th. That's what scares me. This Build Back Better thing needs to go away. It really does. There's the other thing, regulatory items that are in this bill that are so damaging to small businesses, the wage mandates that they put in there, boxing out smaller contractors and businesses from a myriad of different contracts. Again, who's that benefit? Benefits the big companies that can handle it, that can afford to pay it. Which I like to call regulatory captures. Anyway, got to take a quick break here. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back.
And if you ever saw it.
Taking Wall Street's liars, crooks, and cheats out behind the woodshed. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street.
Yes, you are. And again, I got to go through this. I think it's important. Our personal CFO program is available there at our site. It is by far our most popular podcast, too. You know, I still have items at our site that we help people out that we actually started with when we first were helping people out. We still have our account repair program for people who have really taken a beating, gotten ripped off and scammed. We actually started that. The Wolf on Wall Street was still in business, for crying out loud. We were helping people get ripped off by the penny stock firms. But our personal CFO program is about, it's all encompassing, where you learn to navigate financial storms. You learn to navigate corrections, volatility. You have access to all of our attorneys, all of our accountants, us, what we do. And you're able out there to recognize all of the risk. That's how to avoid all of that serious risk, including stuff that, you know what, the occasional black swan that comes out, knowing how to deal with those black swans. You're going to learn, and just by listening to this program as well, you get this via the podcast and this radio show, you're going to learn how to get rid of the narratives, okay? Push the narratives to the side or conventional wisdom, because conventional wisdom is poison, and understand the reality of the terrain. And this is what we do. This is what we do for you. And again, I invite each and every one of you to get to our website, watchdogonwallstreet.com, or give us a call, 800-471-5984. Well, I wanted to quickly mention this because the mainstream media has not. Mainstream media has completely ignored the fact that Biden has gone back on his campaign promises and he's going with the Trumpster. That's right. The United States is going to restart the Remain in Mexico program for asylum seekers. Remember, Joe Biden was telling us that it was dangerous. It was dangerous and inhumane during the campaign. But, they haven't been able to handle what's taking place on our southern border. So they're going back to this Remain in Mexico asylum program. It is a shame that we're not able to figure this out. It really is. It's the government, quite frankly. I mean, did we or did we not have a pretty good system set up where many of our parents or grandparents most now it's a grandparents, worked their way through Ellis Island? That we had a pretty good system set up here. Can we figure this out on how to make this happen and how we can get, you know, work to assimilate people to our society as they come in? I'm not anti-immigrant by any stretch of the imagination. but I'm most certainly anti-chaos immigration, which is basically all we've had. I got to move on. We haven't done this in a while here in the program. We haven't really gotten into foreign policy issues here. And I, as you all, well, my longtime listeners know, I got very strong opinions when it comes to this stuff. I saw this clip. I didn't watch it live. Saw this clip from Neil Cavuto this past week. And I was shaken. Okay? I was shaken. I couldn't say anything. I was just like, I cannot believe what I just saw. You have a Republican senator sitting on the Senate Armed Services Committee. Fox News interview. Yeah, Fox News interview saying, he's talking about the Biden-Putin virtual reality talks, saying that he wouldn't rule out a major American ground war with Russia. Oh, no, but wait, there's more. Senator Roger Wicker, okay, Mississippi, and we are on a plethora of stations in Mississippi. To folks there in Mississippi, I don't like getting involved in the politics in states that I don't reside in. Please vote this guy out. This is Dr. Strangelove here. Yeah, he made the suggestion, national TV, Neil Cavuto, that the United States should not rule out first use nuclear action against Russia in the event that Moscow threatens Ukraine with a military offensive. This guy makes Dick Cheney seem like Big Bird, for crying out loud. Have you lost your mind? Nuclear weapon over Ukraine? Being honest, I've watched a little bit more this week. Again, it's to my own detriment. Not good for my psyche, not good for my mental health by any stretch of the imagination, watching cable news. And I'm watching these wizard of smart retired generals that they have on the payroll to come and talk about all things military all the time, the importance of the Ukraine, and you know, boots on the ground in the Ukraine. What? Well, could be me calling me crazy, okay? I didn't go to West Point, and I didn't go to Naval Academy. Didn't go to the Air Force Academy. But, I remember a game used to take forever and 10 days to play as a kid, Risk. We're not exactly in a very good strategic position. It's right up against Russia. So you mean to tell me you think it's a good idea for us to get into a ground war in the Ukraine that borders Russia with Russia? For what? Why? Why? Well, for what? Because, you know, over the past, I don't know, century, we've been, you know, buddy-buddy with the Ukraine. There are BFFs. Huh? Are you kidding me, people? Anyway, I'm not done with this foreign policy. We're going to get a little further into it because I'm disgusted. I really am. And the idea, I love this conservative Senator Roger Wicker. Conservative in what way? Okay. I'm sorry. The traditional, the real position of the Republican Party used to be non-intervention. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. We'll be back.
Chris Markowski is the Watchdog on Wall Street.